Good morning, class.
Good morning, sir.
Okay, so we are done with how many CPU scheduling? We have seen first come, first serve. Then we have seen round robin. FCFS was what? It was a non-preemptive CPU scheduling. And then we have seen round robin CPU scheduling. That was what? Preemptive CPU scheduling. And in round robin, what is the thing about? We are having a time slot for each processes. Equal time slot was given. And after that time slot has expired, or we can say time quantum has expired, then we will go for next process that is in the ready queue for execution. And then we have seen next shortest job first CPU scheduling. As the name suggests, it is we are picking the shortest job process from the ready queue to send it to the CPU. And in which we are having also two type of shortest job first. First one was non-preemptive shortest job first. What are the characteristics of a non-preemptive shortest job? Non-preemptive shortest job says that firstly you have to pick the smallest burst time process from the ready queue, and as you have selected that process which is having the smallest burst time, you cannot preempt at any later point of time, even though if any smaller process that is having the less burst time than the one which is executing right now in the CPU, you cannot preempt that process. That new smallest burst time process has to wait until and unless that current execution of the process has been completed. So these are the characteristics of the non-preemptive shortest job first CPU scheduling. And now today we will see next variant of shortest job scheduling, that is preemptive shortest job first. So let me quickly revise. Firstly, shortest job first, then we will jump on the preemptive shortest job first CPU scheduling. So I am sharing my screen. And of course, you all are having the pen and paper with you, right? So that we can have some numerical on it side by side. And please be on time as we have only 40 minutes lecture. Okay, so let's start. Firstly, I will quickly revise shortest job first, then we will go for preemptive job scheduling. What is SJF? It associates each process, the length of its next CPU burst is as these lengths to schedule the process with the shortest time. Means the scheduling criteria will decided on the next CPU burst time, that which process is having the smallest CPU burst time, we will select it and send it to the CPU. We are having two schemes. First one non-preemptive and second one is preemptive. What is non-preemptive? Once CPU given to the process, it cannot be preempted until complete its CPU burst. This is the case we have seen in the last class. And the next one is, today's topic is preemptive shortest job first. So preemptive shortest job first is also known as shortest remaining time first. You will get in the examination either shortest remaining time first SRTF CPU scheduling algorithm, or it will be simply written as preemptive SJF scheduling. Then in that case, you have to do what we will learn today. So what is preemptive SJF scheduling? If a new process arrives with CPU burst length less than the remaining time of current executing process, then it has to be preempted. Means the current process which is executing in the CPU, we need to stop that process and pick that new process which arrives that is having the less burst time than the current one which is executing right now. So we will pick the next shortest job process by preempting the current executing process. And which example I have given you yesterday about this, that I am telling the one student arrives to me, a single person, that it wants to revise the concept of CPU scheduling, and I am doing that job, and in between another student come and he just wants my signature on its practical file, then signing a practical notebook, it will take a less time than to explain the whole CPU scheduling algorithm to a student. Then case of preemptive SJF scheduling, I will preempt the current process. That means I will stop the current explaining of CPU scheduling to that student one, and will talk to that student too, that how to solve its problem is sign its notebook. And then I will, once that particular process given completed, means signature has been put on its notebook, then I will go for first one, that which is the next process I will execute. So this is called preemptive SJF. And as you know that SJF is optimal, it gives minimum average time for a given set of processes. So let's see today's topic, preemptive SJF scheduling, preemptive shortest job first scheduling. So for this, we will have some numerical on it and we will see the concept, how to do this kind of questions. So let's have a question. Everyone having pen and paper, please note down that we are having four processes. Their arrival time is given here, 0, 2, 4 and 5. And their bus time is 7414. Time you can think of any unit time, and a bus time you also can we think as a unit time until and unless it specifies in the exam, in the question. So we are having this question. Suppose that the process arrives in the order P1, P2, P3 and P4, and the arrival time is given separately in a different manner. In previous FCFS kind of question, you have seen that we have a flavor of a question in which that each process arrives at time zero, but this is not the case. Here we are having process arriving at different point of time, so we have to take care of this arrival time in solving the question. So what are the things we have to calculate? As usual, we need to find four things. Individual waiting time of the processes. Waiting time is what? It is the time a process has to wait into the ready queue. And what is average waiting time? This is the total average you are taking of those processes waiting time. And then we will have to calculate the turnaround time. What is the turnaround time? It is the how you calculate turnaround time, you have to find the completion time, then minus it with the arrival time, means total time taken by your process to go to the ready queue and get its process completed through the CPU. And then we have to calculate the average turnaround time. Now, let's see how to solve this type of question. I need one student to help me in this. Who wants to help me? Anyone who wants to help me in this question? Akshay, are you there? Akshay, can you hear me? Please unmute yourself. Akshay. Oh, Akshay is not able to listen to me. May we have Asutosh? Asutosh, are you there? Asutosh, can you hear?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, beta. Please stay by my side so that we can solve this question. Okay. So, Asutosh, we are having a process P1, P2, P3, and P4. And then we have some arrival time of different point of time, 0, 2, 4, 5, and bus time is 7414. Okay, actually, no issue. So, Asutosh, at arrival time 0, how many processes are in the ready queue? Can you tell me? At arrival time 0, how many processes are in the ready queue? Asutosh? I think he is not able to listen my voice. Who will help me? Ananya, are you there? Ananya?
Yes, sir.
Can you help me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, at arrival time 0?
Yes.
Tell me the number of processes are in the ready queue. What are the processes at the time 0?
1.
P1 only, right?
1.
Okay, P1. So P1 only. Yes. So there is no issue of any choice, right? So we are having only P1. So we will start with P1 process for execution. So we will start executing P1 until when? After 2 seconds, which process arrives? P2 process arrives, and after 2 minutes, P2 arrives, and after 2 minutes, what is the remaining bus time of P1? 7 minus 2, that is?
5.
Very good. So after 2 seconds, there are two processes in there, P1 and P2, excuse me. And there are two processes, P1 and P2. one minute. There are two processes, P1 and P2. P1 is having remaining bus time as 5 unit time, and P2 is having bus time as 4. So which one we will choose? Which is having the lowest bus time, P1 or P2? Yes, Anandi. P2. So we will choose P2. Okay, so P2 start executing until when? We are having after 4 seconds P3 in the picture. P3 is having one bus time, and P2, how many bus time remaining? 4 minus 2, that is 2, right? So P1, P2, P3. P1 is having 5 bus time remaining. P2, 2 bus time remaining, and P3 is 1. So which one we will choose? We will choose P1, right? Right, Anandi?
Yes,
so P1 will be executed. Now P1 will be given one time slot, one unit time. Then after 5 minutes, what will happen? P3 will finish the execution, and then we will have P1, P2 and P4 only in the picture, because P3 has finished its execution. Now P1 is having 5 bus time, P2 is having 2, and P4 is having 4. Which one we will choose? P2, right? Right? Yes,
better.
Sir. So we will pick P2, and
yes,
P2 will finished after 2 unit time. Then we will choose P4 and then P1. So let's see. Here, this is the table. What is the reasoning we have done till now? That firstly, we are having 7, 4, 1, 4. After 2 unit time, what is the remaining bus time of P1? It is 5. And then you have to choose between P1 and P2, which one is the smallest? 5 or 4, this is 4 is smallest, because after 2 unit time, only P1 and P2 are there in the picture. So after 2 minutes, what is the remaining time of P2? This is 2, and P1 remaining bus time is 5. So for P3, we are having remaining bus time as 1. We will choose P3 because this is P1. P3 is having the smallest bus time. So after 1 minute, what will happen? P3 will complete its execution. Then we have P1, P2 and P4 in the picture. You can see here. So between P1, P2 and of course P4, which one is the smallest? We are having the P2 as the smallest bus time process. So we will firstly pick P2. We will finish its execution. Then we will go for P4 and then we will go for P5. So how to draw the Gantt chart? Here you can see. Firstly, we put the P1 for 2 unit time, right? Then we go for P2 for 2 unit time. Then we go for P3 for 1 unit time. Here you can see P3 for 1 unit time. Then we have seen the 2 unit time for P2. Then for 4 unit time for P4. And then 1 unit time for P1. So this is how Gantt chart we have to draw. So are we good with this? Please tell me yes or no. Shall I repeat? Or you all are on the same page? How to do this shortest remaining time first? Thank you, Ananya. Everyone, please write in the chat box. Do you want to...
Sir, please repeat again. Sir.
Okay, but I will repeat. So let's go back. We are having this question that we are having 4 processes. P1, P2, P3 and P4. Arrival time is given here 0, 2, 4 and 5. And the bus time is 7, 4, 1, 4. So what we have to do at every point of time, once a new process arrives in the ready queue, we have to check it that if smallest process has arrived or not, right? So every time a new process comes into the picture, we have to check if it is smallest or having the larger bus time than the one currently executing. So let's first see that 0 arrival time, there was no point that any other process is in the ready queue. Only P1 is there, right? So firstly, P1, we will pick. Firstly, P1 will be picked. So P1 was start executing, but after 2 unit time, we have seen that P2 will arrive in the ready queue. Now, as per the algorithm, whenever a new process arrives in the ready queue, you have to check whether it is a shortest job or not. So after 2 unit time, we have seen that the remaining bus time of P1 is what? After 2 unit time, remaining time of P1 is 5, we can see. And what is the bus time of P2? Bus time of P2 is what? 4 unit time. So we have seen that the current executing process is remaining bus time is 5 and the new process that arrives in the ready queue is having the bus time 4. Now of course we have seen that we have to choose the shortest job. So we will pick the P2 process and then we will start executing the P2 process, and till then we have to execute this P2 process until our new process arrive in the picture, because we have already checked it with the P1 that it is less than P1 bus time, because P1 is having 5 and P2 is 4 bus time. So we are good that P2 is executing, but when a new process arrives after 4 unit time, that is P3, then we have to again check it that if we have another process which is having the smallest bus time, right? So when we see that P3 is having 1 unit time, here you can see 5 to 1. So in 5 to 1, what we will do? We will go for smallest job. So we will pick the P3. So P3 will be picked after 4 unit time. So it after 1 unit time, P3 will stop executing because it has completed its execution. Then we are having 5 unit time after that, because till P3 we are having 4 unit time and 1 unit time of bus time is passed of P3. Then we are here at 5 unit time. So at this point, P1, P2, P3 and P4, P3 has completed its execution. So we are having P1, P2 and P4 only in the picture. Now, what is the remaining bus time of all these? That P1 is having 5 unit time, P2 2 and P4 4 unit time. So from here you can very easily identify that no new process has arrived in the picture, because only P1, P2 and P4 are there, and we have to pick the smallest. So firstly we will pick the P2, then P4 and then P5. So this is how we will draw the Gantt chart. You can see that till P2 arrives in the picture, P1 was executing in the ready queue. But as soon as P2 arrives in the ready queue, which is having the smallest bus time, then the remaining bus time, here you can see it as here that these are the remaining bus time I have written. So you have to check it with the remaining bus time. So what will happen here that 4 bus time is less than 5 remaining bus time of P1. So we have picked the P2 to go to the CPU. And then after 4 unit time, here you can see in the timeline that after 4 unit time, P3 comes in the picture, which is having the smallest bus time. So we picked the P3 for execution. And then after 5 unit time, you can see that P4 comes in the picture, but P4 is having the bus time of 4, right? So what is the, and P3 has finished execution. So we are here that P4 is having 4 bus time and P2 2 and P1 5. So we firstly pick P2 here for 2 unit time, then we go for P4 for 4 unit time in totality, and then we are remaining 5 bus time will be given to this P1. Now we are okay with this preemptive shortest job scheduling. We simply have to calculate the remaining bus time. As soon as a new process arrives in the ready queue, you have to just check it that if it is having shortest job, you have to send it to the CPU. That's it. This is the basic principle behind shortest remaining time first. Please let me know that we are on the same page. Okay, Krishnam. Others, please let me know. Do you understand? Yes or no? Okay, Firoz, Krishnam, others. Cool. So let's start for waiting time and average waiting time. See the waiting time and average waiting time you can easily find out through the Gantt chart. So the main soul, or you can say crux of this type of question, is this Gantt chart. Once you are done with Gantt chart, waiting time and turnaround time are at your tip of fingertips. So let's see. Here we are having process arrival time and bus time. Here we are having this Gantt chart. Now, what is the waiting time for P1? Can anyone tell me what is the waiting time for P1? As we can see here, P1 is here and P1 is here. So what is the waiting time? Waiting time is the total time process has to wait in the ready queue. Okay. So now tell me what is the waiting time for P1?
11.
Please write in the chat box. Please write in the chat box. Suryansh is saying 9. And please be aware that you all are the students, so you have to write the whole answer. That is 9 unit time. Okay? Don't be in hurry. Give your proper answer, like 9 unit time, something. Very good, Ananya. Very good, Pooja. And Rohit, Asutosh, 9 unit time. Okay, let's see how it is a 9 unit time. As you can see here, that this P1 process arrives at time 0, right? But at time 0, we have given it to the CPU. So this P1 has not to wait, right? But then what will happen? That after 2 unit time, it has to leave the CPU. And when it has to get the CPU after 11 unit time. So what is the in between? It has to wait in the ready queue, right? Because P2 and P4 has their turn in the CPU. Till then, P1 has to wait in the ready queue. So when it get the control at 11, and when it leaves at 2. So 11 minus 2, that is 9. Very good. Now tell me the waiting time for P2. Waiting time for P2. Suryansh is saying 0. Beta, you can see here, P2 is at 2 times here. P2 is here and P2 is here. Aparna 3, Feroz 3, Krishnam 1, Pooja 3. We are having variation in the answer. Abhishek 3. Okay, let me check. So we are talking about P2. P2 arrives at time 2, right? P2 arrives at time 2. So as soon as P2 arrives in the ready queue, we have given it to the CPU, right? At 2 only. So there is no time difference. At 2, it arrives and we have given it CPU to at 2, right? So there is no waiting time in the ready queue. But when it leaves the CPU at 4 unit time. And when it again get the CPU, at 5. So what is the difference? 5 minus 4, that is 1. Ayush, Akramuddin, Abhishek, everyone is saying 3. But this is not true. We are having 1 unit time, because you can see here that it gets the CPU at 2 unit time, but it arrives at time 2 only, right? So as soon as it arrives in the CPU at 2 unit time, it is feeded to the CPU at 2 only, right? So there is no time difference. So no, waiting time is 0 for first turn. And for second turn, what will happen? At 5 unit time, it gets the CPU. And when it leaves the CPU, it leaves the CPU at 4, right? So 5 minus 4 is 1. So Ikhlas, are you okay that we are having 1 unit time as the difference? Ayush, are you clear? Ayush, are you clear that this is not 3 unit time? This will be 1 unit time. Okay, done. Now go for P3. Go for P3 very quickly. Go for P3. Rohit, 4 unit time. Aparna, 0 unit time. Prakhar, 0. Krishnam, 0 unit time. Okay, let's see. Now, where is P4? P4 arrives at 5 unit time, right? And when it is feeded to the CPU at 5 unit time. So very good. This is 0 unit time. Priyam is 0. Ananya is saying 4 unit time. How, Ananya? Ananya? Ananya is saying 4 unit time for P3. How? Beta, P3 arrives at time 4, na? At 4 unit time. And when where is P3? You have feeded to the CPU at 4 unit time only. So there is no waiting time in the ready queue. Okay, so go for P4 now. Go for P4. What is the waiting time for P4? Waiting time for P4. Krishnam 2, Aparna 2 unit time, Prakhar 2 unit time. One more. Okay, Adarsh, 2 unit time. So let's see. Where is P4? Arrival time is 5 unit time. And where is this P4 in the Gantt chart? P4 is here. And when it gets the CPU at 7 unit time, right? So it gets the CPU at 7 unit time, but when it arrives at time 5. So when it gets the control and when it arrives, 7 minus 5, that is 2. Very good. So we are done with the average waiting time of individual processes in the case of shortest remaining time first. Now quickly tell me the average waiting time. what is the average waiting time? Come on, 9 plus 1 plus 0 plus 2 divided by number of processes, that is 4. So very good, we are having the average waiting time as 3. Aparna, very quickly you have done the calculation, 9 plus 1 plus 0 plus 2, very basic mathematics. So we are having 3 unit time as the average waiting time. Now let's go for turnaround time. Turnaround time is very easy, because here what is going to happen, I have shown you the P1. So let's see that when P1 it's finished its execution at 16 unit time, right? And when it arrives at time 0. So completion time minus arrival time, this is the turnaround time. Now tell me the turnaround time for P2. Come on, write the turnaround time for P2. Very good, 5 unit time. And now go for P3. P3 finished its execution at 5 unit time. And when it arrives at 4 unit time. So what is the turnaround time? Very good, Suryansh. Very quickly, 1 unit time. Very good. Now go for P4. Firoz, 1 unit. Ananya, 1. Krishna, 1. Suryansh. Very good. Now go for last one, P4. For P4. Ayush, 1 unit. Very good. Now go for P4, beta. P4. 6 unit time. Krishnam, 6. Aparna, 6. Suryansh, 6. Chitranshu, 6. Very good. So how we calculated the P4 turnaround time? P4 finished its execution at 11 unit time. And when it was in the ready queue at 5 unit time. So completion time minus arrival time, that is 6. Very good. So now what is the average turnaround time? 16 plus 5 plus 1 plus 6 is what? Come on, tell me. Very good. 7 unit time. This is 28. 16 plus 5 plus 1 plus 6. So are we good with shortest job first? SRTF, shortest remaining time first? Yes. Please write in the chat box. Are we good? Can we calculate average waiting time and average turnaround time of shortest remaining time first? Now you have confidence? Okay, cool. Now, so let's have another question so we can see that how much confidence you have gained. Okay, come on. We are having this homework question. We will solve it right now. We are having this question. Now, come on. Tell me the average waiting time and average turnaround time. I will give you 2 minutes for this question. Everyone, go for it. I just need average waiting time and average turnaround time. And you can write your answer in the chat box. Firstly, go for average waiting time. For average waiting time, I am giving you 2 minutes. Average waiting time, you have to calculate. What is the average waiting time? I am giving you 2 minutes for this question. There are 4 processes, P1, P2, P3 and P4. P1 arrives at time 0. P2 after 2 unit time, and then after 2 unit time we are having P3, and after again 2 unit time we are having P4 with the bus time 7. P4 is having bus time 7, P3 6, P2 5 and P1 8. Tell me average waiting time. I will also do it in parallel, okay? P1 we are given 0 at P1, then after 2 unit time we are having P2 in the picture, and then remaining time was P1 was 8 minus 2, that is 6. Then 6 and 5, which is shortest, we are having P2 as the shortest, so we will pick P2 at 2. And after 2 more unit time, what is the remaining bus time for P2? This is 3, but P3 is having 6, so we will go for P2 only, and we will give an all 5 unit to P2. So we are having 7 here, and then we are having 8 minus 2, that is 6. 6 is for P1 and P3 is having the same bus time, that is 6 and 6. So we will go for first come first serve basis, that is P1 will be allotted, and 7 plus 6 is 13, and then we will choose P3. 13 plus 6, 19, and then we will choose P4, 19 plus 7, that is 26. This is the same Gantt chart you have drawn? Tell me, do I draw the correct Gantt chart, or you have draw a wrong Gantt chart? Please tell me. This is the same Gantt chart you are having, or a different one? Tell me, come on, do it fast. This is the same Gantt chart we are having? Yes, sir, same. Abhishek Kumar, Shreyas, yes, Abhishek, same. Very good. Now you are having the Gantt chart. Tell me the average waiting time. Tell me the average waiting time. Come on, tell me the average waiting time. You are having the Gantt chart in your hand. Now you have to simply calculate the average waiting time for P1. What will be the average waiting time for P1? P1 arrives at 0. You have given it CPU at 0. So for first turn of P1, there is no time difference. Then we are having P1 at 7. And when it leaves the CPU at 2, so 7 minus 2, that is 5. So for P1, we are having what? 0 plus 7 minus 2, that is 5, right? And then for P2, what we are having? P2 arrives at 2, and we have feeded it to the CPU, so 0. And then for P3, P3 arrives at 4, and when it gets the control at 13, so 13 minus 4, that is 9. And then for P4, what we are having? For P4, 19, and then minus what? 8, 6, that is 13. So you have to plus 5 plus 0 plus 9 plus 13. What it is? That is 27, right? So 27 by 4, what will happen? 6.75 unit. Okay, so are we good with this? Preemptive SJF scheduling, that is shortest remaining time first. So we are done with today's topic. Okay, so you have to calculate the average turnaround time by yourself. It is very easy. In next two classes, we will be having the class test. Okay, in next two classes, that is on Friday and Saturday, we will be having a class test. I will upload the class test details in your Google Classroom. This will be conducted in the Google Classroom only. So details will be uploaded in the Google Classroom. And the syllabus of this test is whatever we have learned till date of the first unit. So we will having a class test 1.1 and 1.2 on Friday and Saturday. I will mention the time as usual. It will be the same time that is we are having, that is 9 to 9:30. It will be a 30 minute time given for the class test, and maximum marks will be the 10. We will be having 5 questions to solve in 30 minutes. Okay, so keep revise. All the very best for your class test on Friday and Saturday. I will upload the details regarding class test in the Google Classroom. It will be conducted in the Google Classroom only. So till then, keep learning, have practice of all these questions. These are very important for examination perspective and for your intellectual ability also. You have reasoning power, you have the power of imagination. These kinds of things are very much required in your personal as well as professional life. I will upload today's class lecture in the Google Classroom as well. And I will upload slowly all the class recording also in the YouTube for your revision purpose, so that we will be have a comfortable learning environment. And you can refer those classes as and when you required for any concept you have forget or you have missed for my classes for any of reason. Okay, till then, bye bye. Keep learning. Thank you, class. Bye bye.